All right, ladies and gentlemen, if I may pull you away now for the second act of our evening and ask you to return your attention to the stage for the second of our awards. To introduce the Commercial Diplomat of the Year Award and to provide some background into the accomplishments of Secretary Pritzker as Commerce Secretary, we're extremely fortunate to have with us one of the great women leaders that Elise was talking about earlier, Marillyn Hewson, the CEO of Lockheed Martin. Please join me in welcoming Marillyn.
Thank you, David. Well, Secretary Kerry, Secretary Pritzker, ambassadors, distinguished guests, it's really great to see all of you here tonight. And I want to also thank Foreign Policy for hosting this wonderful event. You know, it's an honor for me to be here tonight in order to introduce the Honorable Penny Pritzker, U.S. Secretary of Commerce, who is tonight receiving the Commercial Diplomat of the Year Award. And I can think of no one more worthy of that honor than Penny. Now, several years ago, I had the opportunity, when she was relatively new in her post, to attend another event. And at that, I described Penny as an unshakable optimist. You know, it's good to see that all this time you've been in Washington, Penny, that hasn't changed. Since then, I've had the privilege of working with Secretary Pritzker and traveling with her as part of the President's Export Council. I've had a chance to see her in action. She's a tireless advocate for U.S. businesses, and I've seen her increased commitment to U.S. trade and exports all around the world. From the start, she recognized that increased trade means creating jobs and sustaining livelihoods here in the United States. Her efforts have helped the U.S. companies to compete and win in the global marketplace. But she also recognized that trade is about strengthening international partnerships and building new relationships. Now, while it may seem outside the normal portfolio of a U.S. Commerce Secretary, I can attest that this Secretary of Commerce has understood that there is no bright line distinction between what is good for our country's economy and what is good for our country's security. In this way, Secretary Pritzker truly embodies what it means to be a commercial diplomat. She understands that trade brings all of us closer together and makes the United States stronger, more reliable, and a long-term international partner. She has made American industry more competitive in the global marketplace, opening up new opportunities abroad, encouraging sustainable innovation that keeps America's businesses and manufacturers on the cutting edge of technology, and facilitating investment to grow the economy and create jobs. Those are all objectives that are important to our company, Lockheed Martin, and they're important to all American exporting companies and their employees. Penny, I look forward to working with you and continuing to support your efforts. I want to congratulate you on a job well done and for receiving an honor well deserved. Thank you for your service, and thank you for your continued commitment to supporting U.S. business and commercial diplomacy around the world. Ladies and gentlemen, Secretary Pritzker.
Marillyn, thank you. Thank you for that extraordinary introduction, and more importantly, thank you for your partnership. It has been really important to me to know that whenever I've had to pick up the phone to call Lockheed Martin about whatever issue around the world, I've always gotten a great assessment of what the situation is on the ground. And I'm also proud that the U.S. government is a customer of Lockheed Martin, and we at the Department of Commerce are no exception, as they are producing our satellites that give us our weather service. So I'm very grateful also for your attention to our satellites. David, thank you very much. I am really honored to be the inaugural recipient of the Commercial Diplomat of the Year Award. David, during your time as Deputy Undersecretary of Commerce at the International Trade Administration, you came to clearly understand the meaning and importance of commercial diplomacy. And you understood that it was a cornerstone of our foreign policy. Over the past 2 years, David has been an essential thought partner as our department has developed our strategy to engage around the world. And I want to thank you for your friendship and your excellent stewardship. I also want to acknowledge my fellow awardees, Secretary Kerry and Vital Voices. John, I've known you and Teresa for a long time, and I deeply appreciate your friendship. It has been a pleasure to serve in the cabinet together and to develop a different kind of relationship, one as colleagues. I admire your devotion to our country. Your lifetime of leadership in foreign affairs is simply unparalleled. For this administration, you have worked tirelessly on a myriad of issues, from our negotiations in Iran to the recent conclusion of the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And for me personally, you've been a constructive and supportive partner on a wide cross-section of issues. I'm proud to know you as a good friend, as a colleague, and tonight as a fellow awardee. To Vital Voices, thank you for working every day to empower women leaders and social entrepreneurs worldwide, to combat violence against women and girls, and to equip women with the skills needed to build businesses, provide for their families, and create jobs in their communities. Last year, it was my honor and privilege to join you in paying tribute to your third annual Diplomat of the Year, IMF Managing Director Christine Lagarde, and at that event to share the Commerce Department's vision for the use of commercial diplomacy as an essential tool of U.S. foreign policy. In accepting this award tonight, I'm delighted to have the opportunity to briefly revisit the core tenets of commercial diplomacy and to discuss our initial progress in three crucial countries on three separate continents, India, Tunisia, and Ukraine. In my more than 2 years in office, I have visited 33 countries. I've met with heads of state, economic ministers, and over 2,000 business leaders. From these experiences, I've observed three important constants that form the backbone of commercial diplomacy. First, people want economic freedom, the chance to earn a good living, start a business, and support a family. Second, foreign governments want American companies to invest in their countries because U.S. firms create jobs, bring leading technologies, respect the rule of law, and invest in the communities where they are located. And third, foreign citizens want to access U.S. products and services. At the Commerce Department, we understand that these factors, the desire for economic opportunity, mixed with the demand for U.S. businesses and services, represent a tremendous opportunity for our private sector and our government to work together as partners in support of important policies and reforms. From our earliest beginnings as a nation, we have always recognized the importance of partnerships in a global context. Benjamin Franklin once said, "There is a sanction like that of religion, which binds us in partnership in this serious work of the world." In other words, he was saying, we should devote ourselves to the critical work of partnership in the world with an almost duty-bound intensity. By bringing our public and private sectors together Commercial diplomacy applies the vital importance of partnership to the task of leveraging our economic power. When and where the interests of business and government overlap, whether improving the rule of law, enhancing protection of trade secrets and intellectual property, or increase access in foreign markets, we have the capacity to deploy our commercial might in support of our strategic and diplomatic objectives. Together, this combination of business and government can be a powerful tool. Together, we have created new opportunities for American business abroad. Together, we have strengthened our country's international economic leadership. When business leaders advocate for broader private sector interests in meetings with foreign officials, they are often echoing the economic and commercial policy goals of our administration. And they can paint a clear, tangible picture for foreign leaders of the economic benefits that will flow from smart reforms. In markets around the world, we are putting our theory of commercial diplomacy to the test. Let me begin with India. When President Obama first visited New Delhi in 2010, he set forth his vision to make the U.S.-India relationship one of the defining partnerships of the 21st century. Our two countries are the world's oldest and largest democracies. We share strong military, political, and diplomatic ties. Yet despite Prime Minister Modi's recent steps to strengthen India's business climate and expand our ties of trade and investment, our nation's commercial relationship simply has not lived up to its enormous potential. In fact, India, the second largest country and fastest growing economy on the planet, is only America's 11th largest trading partner and 18th largest export market. Given the headwinds in the global economy, neither of us can afford this underperformance any longer. For the broader U.S.-India partnership to grow stronger, our economic ties cannot lag behind. Commerce must be a foundational component of our relationship. Prime Minister Modi and President Obama appreciate that our economic futures are interconnected, which is why they challenged their economic teams to increase trade between our two countries fivefold. To deliver on this ambitious goal, they established the U.S.-India Strategic and Commercial Dialogue, which Secretary Kerry and I co-chair, and we have permanently linked the reinvigorated U.S.-India CEO Forum to the Strategic and Commercial Dialogue. Reaching $500 billion in two-way trade will require the active participation of our private sectors. That is why we have given businesses, American and Indian, a platform to speak directly to and with senior representatives from each of our governments, as well as hold us accountable for progress. This is commercial diplomacy in action. Since sparking the Arab Spring in 2011, Tunisia has undergone a remarkable and historic political transformation. The new Tunisian government overcame the threat of civil war and successfully established a constitutional system that guarantees basic fundamental rights for its entire population, including women and minorities. This incredible progress, which was recently recognized by the Nobel Peace Prize Committee, is proof that democracy is not only possible, but also necessary in North Africa and the Middle East. Tunisia's success can be a beacon for the entire region. For that reason, helping the Tunisian government build a brighter future is a top strategic priority for the United States. Yet for the country's political transformation to be sustained, Tunisia needs economic growth, and its young people need opportunity. Indeed, promoting stability and creating economic growth are essential components of their ongoing fight against extremism. Since my visit to Tunis in March, with the support of our private sector, we have engaged President Kaid Essebsi and Prime Minister Asid to focus on the need for economic reform. Last May, we convened 20 U.S. business executives at Blair House to discuss the reforms necessary for Tunisia to attract more American investment. Since then, Tunisia has implemented two critical measures: legislation to recapitalize its two largest state-owned banks, and a new law to increase transparency, improve regulations, and strengthen its competition council. Unquestionably, their government has a long way to go. But still, they need to adopt a new investment code and pass an essential public-private partnership law. Yet we remain convinced that Tunisia's leaders are committed to traveling the difficult road of reform. And the U.S. government and U.S. businesses must and will continue to be part of the solution. The same is true for Ukraine, a country that remains under siege from its neighbor. Russia's brazen attempt to redraw Europe's borders and undermine the stability of a sovereign nation, including by attempting to create conditions that will cause an economic collapse, threatens the whole continent. Neither the United States government nor the United States business community wants to see this cynical strategy succeed. The emergence of a Ukraine that is independent, prosperous, democratic, and free from corruption is good for our country and good for business. Perhaps more than any other example, our engagement with Ukraine is illustrative of the slow but steady progress we can make with commercial diplomacy. In September 2014, at President Obama's request, I traveled to Kyiv to urge President Poroshenko and Prime Minister Yatsenyuk to address corruption and create a level playing field for all businesses. Our discussions led to the passing of the National Anti-Corruption Bureau through the RADA less than 2 weeks later, which sent a positive signal to outside investors. In recognition of that progress and other measures, this past summer, the Department of Commerce convened the first ever U.S.-Ukraine Business Forum in Washington. We were joined by Vice President Biden and Prime Minister Yatsenyuk. This event marked a critical opportunity for the Prime Minister and his government. It was an opportunity to share Ukraine's progress on the path to reform with more than 150 Ukrainian and American business executives and government officials. It was an opportunity for business leaders to offer concrete recommendations to further improve Ukraine's investment climate. It was an opportunity to demonstrate the constructive role the private sector can play in supporting Ukraine's integration into the global economy, which will also enhance the country's long-term political stability. When I went to Kyiv last year, I delivered my message alone. Next week, I'll return to Ukraine at the request of President Poroshenko and Prime Minister Yatsenyuk, accompanied by senior U.S. business leaders. Together, we will talk specifically about what Ukraine can do to further attract trade and investment. Together, we will also work to further Ukraine's efforts towards reform. Ukraine has a long way to go, but we will continue to work and support Ukraine as the government tackles corruption and reforms its economy. The fundamental fact about America's global leadership in the 21st century is that we can no longer rely solely on our military strength, our strategic influence, or traditional diplomatic tools to advance our interests and values around the world. We must use every resource at our disposal. We must deploy every tool in our foreign policy toolkit. We must adopt a more multidimensional approach to building, sustaining, and strengthening our relationships with allies and partners. And commercial diplomacy must continue to be a top priority. In countries like India, Tunisia, and Ukraine, we are making progress. We are seeing that a vibrant partnership between our government and our businesses can play a critical role in deepening our commercial relationships, shaping a well-functioning international economic order, and promoting a future of peace and prosperity for communities across the globe. Once again, thank you for this award, and congratulations to my fellow honorees, and go Cubs.
Out of respect to Secretary Pritzker, I will not revert to what my New York roots would have me revert to there, and instead, in honor of Secretary Kerry, I'll say, at my heart, it's always go Pats. In a moment, after your plates have been cleared and your desserts are in places, we will return for the big third act and our remarks honoring the accomplishments of Secretary Kerry. Please enjoy the next few minutes, and we'll see you in just a few. Thank you.